The evolutionary intent of your life is to be you? Yellow, Ralph McIntyre with Astromat Links. Well, you guessed it, here to do another video. Someone's been typing in my comment, asking me questions. We're not gonna directly talk about Pluto, but you know I can't help myself. I'm gonna talk a little bit about Pluto. Bianca asked about planets conjunct the ascendant or in the first house. So we're going to get into it. And it's interesting, a lot of people have been talking about karma. And we have the nodes in Libra and Aries. I think I might do another. I've been saying that for the last couple of nights, so hopefully I'll actually do this. But I might actually do a video. I've been getting a lot of downloads as I think about it. But anyways, let's get to the first house. And anytime you have planets in the first house, you have a big first house. And if you got big planets in the first house, you got a big, big first house. And we got a big planet. I think technically from size-wise, besides the sun, this might be the biggest planet as known as Jupiter. So we're dealing with a Taurus rise with a Jupiter conjunct the rise in the first house. We also have the moon there, but the moon is jumping forward into Gemini. And so we'll look to an Aries Venus and an Aries Mercury in the 11th house, as well as an Aries South Node up there. So we got a lot to unpack here. So the rise, the persona, how you see the world, how the world sees you. One of my favorite ways to really unpack the first house, really understand what the evolutionary intent of your soul. So you got to understand, it's like if you think about astrology, is your higher self in the divine universe conspiring to help break you through free of your ego? And so wherever you have placements, it's kind of where the ego needs to, so to speak, let go of old personas, you know? And having Jupiter in the first house, enlightened selfishness is something I use when I'm talking about the first house in general, but Jupiter's where you underestimate yourself. Jupiter in Taurus is where you underestimate your need for calm. Let me say that again. Jupiter in Taurus in the first house is where you underestimate your need for calm and relaxation. And then interestingly enough, that's ruled by an Aries Venus. And then we have the moon over there in Gemini wanting to kind of rethink, relook, kind of do it a different way, ruled by an Aries Mercury. So we got a lot of Aries energy in this chart, ruled by a Piscean Mars. So if you think about why we have these placements, so one of the aspects about Jupiter is it's not only where you underestimate. And the reality is we all underestimate ourselves. If you think about the divine reality of what we're truly capable of, you know, and what we actually believe we're capable of, there's like this ginormous distance in between the two. And Jupiter is kind of the bridge in between what is possible and what we believe is possible. And so much of what we believe is taught to us by other people, by our society, by our familial family upbringing, the ways in which our clan, so to speak, do things, you know? What is a good girl? What is a good boy? What is a responsible girl, sister, mother, daughter? What is a responsible boy, man, father, son? Husband, what does that mean? Well, so much of that is defined by society. And Jupiter is kind of like represents an area where you may have to let go of, you know, that reality to make room for another reality. And so by taking care of your calmness, what does that do? Well, interestingly enough, when you think about that Venus ruled by that Pisces Mars, It allows you to connect into the other realm. The more you take care of yourself, the more you put your needs ready, the more you can take care of other people. You know, there's that old saying, it's like if you give a man a fish, you feed him for a night. You teach a man how to fish, and you feed him for a lifetime. And so, on some levels, this is what I want to talk a little bit about. It's like enlightened selfishness is like learning how to give by taking. You know, the more healthy you are, the more you can give. And so, if you have this connection to the divine and you're supposed to channel this divine wisdom, you know, and a lot of times, especially a lot of people that I find into astrology, a lot of people with a Pisces signature in their chart, this is also a Neptune and Sag generation in general. You Neptune and Sag generation have a lot of wisdom that wants to come through. And so it's important to think about the timing of all this, because Neptune and Sag came in the you know, late 60s, 70s. And the world was a very interesting place then. It's like a lot of the needs of, you know, you think of history, what was needed to be done in history compared to what is needed to be done now. You think about just food, just like shelter, all the different things, you know. It's so much easier for us to provide that for ourselves now than it was, you know, 100 years ago, 200 years ago. And so as we evolve as a society, the complexity of our needs change. And so bringing in this new divine wisdom, you know, Jupiter represents what you believe, represents what you need to let go of and what you need to bring in. Also noticing that Taurus is in this person's, or excuse me, Uranus in Taurus is in this person's 12th house. So right now, there's a lot of wisdom that wants to come through. A lot of, so to speak, fixing and changing, saving us all, so to speak, teaching us how to fish. You know, so if you focus too much on feeding us fish, giving us your fish of the day, you won't be able to, so to speak, feed us in the future by teaching us how to feed ourselves. So enlightened selfishness, enlightened selfishness, enlightened selfishness. And interestingly enough, I love how astrology quite often will tell us the same thing over and over and over again. So we got two big planets, the moon and Jupiter, in the first house. So we know that we're kind of needing to put ourselves first. And both of those are ruled by planets in Aries. And then we have a big Mars up in the 10th house. So it's like on some levels, the more you put your needs first, the more you're going to be able to take care of everyone else's needs. And the more you take that emotional needs and the complexity of that. I know this person fairly well. I know that they have children and a family. And so a lot of times, especially for mama bear, to put her needs first in a family is complex, because there's the need to be a good mother, and a need to be a good person to yourself. And those needs sometimes conflict. And so I have this concept I've been playing with around Gemini, and that is that if you have a conflict, you have a problem, you're not being Gemini. Because Gemini sees all the solutions in all different directions. And so the more you open up to looking at it from a different perspective, and this is what this Jupiter is kind of saying, hey, let go of the old way of looking at it and come up with a new way of looking at it. You know, letting go of the persona of yesterday. You know, one of the things that about karma for me is it's like karma's a lot more about habits than it is anything else. We bring these habits from past lives forward, and then we blame all sorts of other things on them. And so by breaking some of the habits of taking care of others over taking care of self, and this is where it gets complicated, you know? It's not as simple just like abandon everyone in your life, because that's not going to work for you either. So first house, what's good for me is good for you on some levels is one way of looking at it. If it's not good for me, it's not good for you. If mama doesn't take care of mama, how does the kids know how to take care of themselves? If the mama doesn't put her needs first, how do the kids ever need to know to put their needs first? All right, well, I hope this you find this helpful. I might get a little more into this first house at some point. And thank you so much for watching this video. Have a spectacular day.